Hello and welcome to The German Guy Reviews. I'm The German Guy. And welcome back, my dearest friends, to another edition of Kingdom Hearts, a retrospective. With the incredible useful information we received from the magic mirror, we go on into another world, which is, surprise surprise, yet another kingdom. So, there is this legend in Kingdom Hearts that all the different worlds will one day reunite into one big world. How are they going to decide which political system they are going to have? And if they all decide that it's going to be a monarchy, which monarchy is going to rule over the rest? I think it's gonna be kind of bloody. Here, Terra finds a crying Cinderella in the park, whose dress was torn apart. Good evening, rape themes in media. We meet again. No, actually, she tells us that her evil stepmother and stepsisters destroyed her dress so she could not go to the ball tonight. Yeah, and also mention the years of imprisonment and mental abuse, cause only hearing this one story makes me think that this was just a average, normal fight between mean sisters. Certainly mean, but not evil, and this is why context is important. Terra tells her that darkness will always enter wounded hearts, so she must be strong in order to keep it away. The best thing you can do for your life is to have no feelings at all. At least that's my takeaway from Equilibrium. I just made this discovery! Terra means Earth! Earth? Rocks? He is like a rock? Clever! You know, I always hated persons like the stepmother more than any other evil character. Many people do, in fact. But that's actually not that all surprising. A lot of people in the comment section of Harry Potter videos, for example, write that they hate Umbridge more than Voldemort, and I can totally understand why. The reason for this is that most of us are not personally familiar with violent dictators. We are, however, also familiar with assholes. You know, the kind of people that are always mean without any reason. Douchebags who are criminals even then when they don't break laws. The kind of people that you just know that if a violent dictator would rise to power, would not hesitate 1 minute to join him. We hate this kind of scum, often more than we hate the evil all the way characters, because we can't do anything about it. A wall can be torn apart, a dictator can be put on trial, but you can't make a cold heart illegal, and that's infinitely frustrating. Anyway, Unversed appear and Terra fights them off. Cinderella, who did not run away during all of this, for some reason could not be calmed down by senseless violence. A voice appears out of nowhere, saying that a strong heart is indeed important, but faith is too. It's the fairy godmother, kindly telling Cinderella that she is here to help.
You've got to dream a little harder, when life will go your way, simply dream a little harder. Trust me when I say that when you dream a little harder, you're sure to follow through. You're good and you're attractive, no need to be proactive.
Good things will just happen to you.
She pippity-poppity-pimps a nearby pumpkin, magically repairs Cinderella's dress, and says she will have a wonderful evening, but only until midnight, by the stroke of 12. Then the spell will be broken.
Hello! I'm a representative of the universe, and for your awful life I can give you one good day.
Evening. Why the hell is good magic so freaking weak? I mean, for God's sake, the evil stepmother in Cinderella 3 could travel back in time. Anyhow, Terra asks the fairy godmother what she did that made Cinderella so happy from one minute to the next. She asks a counter question, wanting to know if Terra believes if dreams can come true. Yes, of course, every night before I go to bed I wish upon a star, but I can't help but notice that they keep disappearing. Terra says yes, but he adds that one has to make an effort to achieve them.
Heretic.
But no, the fairy godmother also agrees. That's exactly her intention. She says sometimes believing in dreams is easier said than done. She wanted to show Cinderella that she is right in her beliefs, that dreams do indeed can come true. If someone never gets any confirmation for one's beliefs, then those beliefs eventually die. Leave it to Kingdom Hearts to explain to you the meaning of fairy tales. If it doesn't explain anything else. Her fairy godmotherness helped her in this way. She would not lose her faith and get more self-esteem. I mean, I get where she is coming from. By doing this kind thing for her, she not only shows her that her dreams can come true, but she also shows her that there are countless of people out there who care about her, that there are more good people than awful people, that she is not alone. But I think what she needs is less a dress, but someone from Amnesty International who saves her abused ass. Some Onvers try to stop Cinderella from entering the palace, and apparently all guards are wasted in a gutter somewhere, so it's our job to save a young girl's dream. She then dances with Prince Charming, while her stepmother and stepsisters have this to say.
But who is she, mother? Do we know her?
It's Cinderella in a dress! What the heck is wrong with you? Are you looking at her at home that little? I can't believe that people wouldn't see that Clark Kent and Superman are the same person, cause not wearing glasses and a different hairstyle can make a huge difference. But this? Then again, this is a video game universe. So I guess this actually does look to you like an actual shitten. However, some Onvers try to crash the party while playing the most awesome boss music ever. After the battle, Terra asks the Grand Duke how long these monsters have been attacking the kingdom. The Duke answers that it's actually very recent. The Onvers appear together with a boy in a mask whose commands they obeyed. Unfortunately, we had a Mysterion cosplay contest the same day. The clock tower informs Cinderella that it's starting to get late. She runs out of the castle but loses one of her shoes. Terra sees Aqua standing in the entrance hall and she tells him that Ven has run away from home. Aqua wonders if he knows why. Terra recalls that Ven wanted to tell him something, but he didn't listen. Terra then brings Aqua up to speed about what he found out so far, that Master Xehanort searches for Hearts of Pure Light. His friend replies that she is going to stay and search for more clues. Before he leaves, Terra tells Aqua that she can thank Cinderella for making him realize that sometimes believing in something is enough.
Show me my destiny, fortune cookie!
Later that day, Terra visits Yen Sid. He tells him what he knows and asks for guidance. Yen Sid doesn't really have an answer, he just tells him that he should maybe view the Unversed and Master Xehanort disappearing as one and the same problem.
Because connecting things to one another, which we have no evidence for if they are related, is how a good detective operates.
The real point of that scene, however, was to show us that Mickey is also on a quest. Shortly after that, Terra is to much surprise telepathically connected by Xehanort, who tells him they have to meet at once.
Which is a power he only uses in this game and never again. And the reason why he just didn't open up a portal, walked up to him and told him to follow him to the place he wanted to talk, is that... he tells him where to go and Terra finds him on a deserted planet where I believe the Mad Max movies took place. Xehanort claims he only wanted to protect the light from the boy in the mask, whose name is Vanitas. He admits to us that Vanitas is a being of his own making. When he and Ventus trained, darkness was about to overcome the boy. So in order to save him, he ripped that part out of him, thus creating Vanitas. In that process, Ventus' heart was badly damaged. His evil part bought an airship and searched for the Dragon Balls. Because Xehanort did not want a constant reminder of his own failure, he left Ventus with Master Arrakis. This explains why Ventus was like a zombie the first time they met. The old master begs Terra to find Vanitas and stop him. He thinks that because Vanitas is a being of absolute darkness and naturally evil seeks to destroy light, he will go to a place where there is lots of goodness, like Radiant Garden for example. As soon as he enters the city, Onvers start to attack, which confirms that Master Xehanort was right. After some fighting and a quick chat with Merlin, who thank god has not figured out yet that there is a whole world inside the Winnie the Pooh book, saving me from a lot of suffering, the young Keyblade wielder sees a giant Onvurst and decides to follow. It turns out that a giant Onvurst was just one part of an even bigger creature. All three Keyblade heroes come together to fight it. Thanks to teamwork, they can kill the beast and claim victory. Ventus begins the conversation by giving his friends two tickets to a theme park he got for saving Scrooge McDuck. His name is Dagobert in the German version, by the way. I don't know why I thought this was so important that I had to write it down, but here we are. And there's no turning back. The aforementioned tickets are for Disney Town, not to be confused with any other place. Why the name change? Did the Disney company threaten to sue their own product? Terra wants Aqua to take Ventus home since they are on a dangerous mission, but of course Ventus would rather go with them.
Why are you giving commands, dude? We have ranks for a reason.
The young Keyblade Master interrupts, asking what exactly his task is. From her perspective, it doesn't look at all like what their master asked them to do. Terra assures her that he is maybe taking a different route, but he is still fighting the darkness. Aqua isn't so sure about that. She explains that she has been to the worlds he has been to, and that she knows what he did. Stealing hearts, helping villains, it doesn't at all look like heroes' work. Offended about the fact that Arrakis doesn't trust him and sent Aqua to spy on him, he leaves the group, saying that he will work alone from now on. Aqua tries to calm him down, saying their master was only worried, but Terra doesn't want to hear it.
Stupid master, only because he is absolutely right.
Thinking to himself that Xehanort is the only person he can trust, he storms off. His thought gets interrupted, however, when he is spoken to by a local fog named Brake, who you all can clearly see will later become Zigba. He claims he took Xehanort as prisoner and will kill him if he doesn't come and get him. Terra doesn't believe for a second that a Keyblade Master could be beaten by some nobody criminal, but then again, there's no harm in looking. Shocked, he discovers that Brake was telling the truth. Master Xehanort is chained up like Popeye's girlfriend. Brake says he wants our Keyblade and that he will shoot Xehanort if he tries to fight back.
Okay, here, take it. So here we are now.
Master Xehanort, however, says we have to win at all costs, and how shameful a defeat would be. In the only lazily made boss battle that I have ever seen in the entire series, it's the exact same copy-paste tactics as in Kingdom Hearts 2, Terra is victorious. We are ordered to use the powers of the Keyblade, and Terra does just that. He fires a ball of dark energy at Brake, destroying his right eye and freeing Xehanort. Terra is ashamed of himself, since the power he just used was the power of darkness, that of hate and anger, the same powers that made him take Princess Aurora's heart. Xehanort, on the other hand, is proud, offering a chance to become his pupil.
Have you ever heard the tragedy of death, Plagueis the Wise?
He claims darkness is not the only thing that people can succumb to. He explains that his master is blinded by light, forgetting that light always breeds shadows. Light and darkness, in his opinion, must be kept in balance.
What exactly does succumbing to light look like? Sure, you can do a bad thing for a greater good, but then that bad thing is automatically part of the evil corner of the spectrum.
He goes on to tell him that he thinks the only reason that Terra is not a Keyblade Master yet is because his master fears him and what he is capable of. Xehanort wants that Terra joins him so that they can spread light and darkness equally across the universe. For every orphanage we build, we shall rob a bank. For every hostage we save, we shall punch a random person on the street. And our name shall be the Nonsense Force. Xehanort then gives Terra the title of Master and says he needs to search for Vanitas and kill him. Humbled by this honor, Terra agrees to his new master's request and sets out on his new mission. He says goodbye to Ven, telling him that he knows that if he really needs him, he will be there. We then return to Master Xehanort and a very pissed Brake, who is not at all happy about the fact that this job has costed him an eye. The old man puts him back in his place, and in the following discussion between the two, it is revealed it wasn't Terra that stole Aurora's heart, but him. Back to Terra, who suddenly appears in Super Mario Kart. If you think Square Enix is asking for it here, wait until we get to Super Mario Party Kingdom Hearts Edition. Anyway, there is absolute carnage on the racetrack, because there are some unversed. Yeah, the forces of evil need to get their priorities straight. We also meet this fellow, Captain Dark. Did that Superman knockoff from Dr. Slum fall into the same chemical bath that the Joker fell into and then later watch the aerobic instruction videos from the Genyu Force? Terra is asked by Queen Minnie to solve the problem, and that's what he does. In a race. Okay. Just so you know, Terra, if you lose this race while using the space motorcycle, I'm filing for divorce. But no, we managed to win, and that somehow makes the unversed go away. We then get an explanation why Pete is running around like a G-list Marvel supervillain. There is a prize given to the most exceptional person in town, voted by the citizens. Hey, that's somehow a very neat and cool idea. Can we also in the future choose the leader we want? Off with his head! Seriously, Minnie, why are you introducing your citizens to such crazy ideas? Before you know it, they will overthrow the government and the entire world will descend into dirty, dirty democracy. Because nobody likes Pete, and because he simply doesn't get the spirit of common decency the festival is about, he thought wearing a disguise would fool everybody. And they actually did not recognize him. They first started to suspect that things were a little bit fishy when they read some of his backstory. He is an alien from another planet, but also from another dimension, and a government experiment, and summoned by all of our ancestor spirits to save us? Later, the winners of this year's festival are announced. Terra, Aqua and Ventus. Furious that he didn't win, Pete runs on the stage and makes a fool of himself.
There's gotta be a mistake. Everybody voted for Captain Justice, I made sure. Now go on, tell her. Better try the other one. The Rogue Racer, Captain Dark!
You should feel bad.
Minnie tries to get through his thick skull, saying this fest is about showing how people care for one another. She tells him that she does believe he wanted to do good, but for the wrong reasons, and that he should appreciate the few votes he got. But being a giant dickhole, Pete shrugs this off, making clear that he is only interested in the prize. Really? The broomsticks are also your guards? Be thankful that you have the Cornerstone of Light, you guys, because otherwise you would have been conquered by Spring Lee's five times over by now. And let me guess, the reason why you don't have weapons is because you let Pluto, Donald and Goofy, in this order, guard your armory. Hey Chip and Dale, how is that nuclear bomb project coming along?
Ooh, very nice.
They throw him into a parallel universe dungeon, where he eventually is contacted by Maleficent, who is building her army of rogues. You put someone in solitary confinement in the Phantom Zone because he wasn't very nice? Yeah. Yeah, I guess it was Winston Churchill who once said, "Draconian law might not be a good kind of law, but it's the best we have." Since there are three winners, but only Terra is here, he takes the prize on their behalf. A special flavored ice cream just for him. It's a taste that doesn't actually exist in our reality, but it's one of those positive side effects we got from building our special prison. By the way, the prize can also be won by Aqua and Ventus, but only if you play their character later. Each character then plays a different game when he or she visits Disney Town, trademarked. Aqua plays beach volleyball against the Unversed, and Ventus tests Huey Dewey's and Louie's new ice cream machine. Which is actually an ice cream cannon and probably a leftover from the last war. What, you think all these different species just came all together to live in harmony just like that? Oh no, my friends, the path to peace was paved in blood and steel. Wait a second, this game takes place 10 years before Kingdom Hearts 1, and you three have not aged one day since then? You three have been smoking, haven't you? Admit it! Anyway, it's quite hot today, if you can tell, so I guess I need to cool down for a moment and continue later. See German guy out and auf Wiedersehen.